Well, welcome to this edition of the 700 Club. The price of the economic stimulus bill in the Senate keeps going higher. Surprise, surprise.
Not really.
Well, now it's $885 billion.
But with the economy weakening, President Obama says that that bill is necessary, and both sides say they want a compromise. John Jessup has the story from Washington.
In Washington state, unemployment is at a record level. With 14,000 new claims last week alone, state officials decided to add extra Saturday hours to meet the demand for people seeking work.
We logged 19,000 overtime hours in the last 4 months.
With millions of Americans anxious about losing their jobs.
I'm afraid of being losing everything I have, my house, everything, because I don't know if I'll be able to afford my bills.
The bleak outlook is forcing some to look for work overseas.
It was United Arab Emirates. I'll go anywhere in the world for a good job at this point in time.
President Obama says his economic recovery plan will help by saving or creating 3 million jobs.
We hope to be able to get a bill to you in the next couple of weeks so we can put America back to work and start digging ourselves out of this deep hole that we're in.
But with a price tag nearing $1 trillion and lobbyists lining up to raise the final cost even more, Republicans aren't buying in, at least not yet.
If you started spending the day that Jesus was born and you spent $1 million every single day, you still wouldn't have spent $1 trillion. It's a lot of money. Our goal is to produce a bill that makes a difference.
Republicans say the current plan is loaded with wasteful pork. They want to spend less and funnel more money toward tax relief and to combat the mortgage meltdown. But Democrats say the bill addresses one central issue.
This package for economic recovery and reinvestment is about jobs, number one, jobs, number two, and jobs, number three.
President Obama calls the differences between the parties modest, but he's putting pressure on his own party to reach a bipartisan consensus. To iron out those differences, a team of about 10 senators from both sides of the aisle are combing through the bill, looking to weed out unnecessary spending that won't help immediately stimulate the economy.
The president wants the stimulus package on his desk and ready to go by the middle of the month. But that's easier said than done unless both sides can agree on the bill's spending provisions. Still, Republicans and Democrats want to be seen as providing real aid to an economy stuck in the worst recession in more than a quarter century. John Jessup, CBN News, Washington.
Thanks, John. You know, folks, they've got to have something serious. Infrastructure spending can build an economy, but there needs to be something serious. And I heard Senator Conrad, who I believe is chairman of the Senate Budget Committee, he said certain parts of the House bill don't pass the laugh test. They're just so ludicrous what they've put into this thing, and that we can't waste money on stuff like that. We've got to spend it on serious matters, and if it takes a lot, a big chunk, just think what would happen if we spent a lot of money on nuclear power. Think what would happen if we spent a great deal of money on perfecting solar power. Think what would happen if we did the research necessary to run our cars off hydrogen instead of gasoline. Can you imagine what would happen if we really, honest to goodness, did that? But we've got a little bit here and a little bit there and all these pork projects. And when it's all finished, we'll find ourselves deep in debt, and our children and grandchildren will still be digging their way out of it. It is very flawed. We don't have to hurry on this thing. Hurry will make definite mistakes that will come back to haunt us. Well, Lee Webb has the rest of our top stories from the CBN newsroom. Lee.
Pat, a White House official says President Obama is, quote, absolutely sticking with his choice of Tom Daschle to head the Health and Human Services Department. Daschle has told his former Senate colleagues he's embarrassed and disappointed about his failure to pay more than $128,000 in back taxes. Daschle has since paid those taxes on the use of a friend's car and driver.
I deeply apologize to President Obama, to my colleagues, and to the American people. I would hope that my mistake could be viewed in the context of 30 years of public service.
Melanie Sloan, though, the executive director of Citizens for Responsibility and Ethics, referred to Treasury Secretary Timothy Geithner when she said, if the guy who is overseeing the IRS can get away with a tax problem, how are you going to hold up the Health and Human Services Secretary over taxes? Pat?
Well, I tell you, he held up a lot of judges over things that were much, much less consequential than this. They were brutal, brutal on President Bush's nominees for various courts, circuit courts, others. That's the reason Daschle got so roundly defeated. People all over America were pouring money into his opponent's campaign in South Dakota to get him out of that office. And I don't understand this thing. I really don't, because it's on the margin. A company provides a car and a driver. How does that suddenly get into $128,000 worth of taxes? That's the math I can't understand. But nevertheless, he should know better. He's got tax advice. He made, I think the number was $5 million last year, so he isn't exactly poverty-stricken. Lee?
Americans overwhelmingly disapprove of people who cheat on their taxes. That's the finding of an annual survey released just in time for tax season. 89% said it's never okay to cheat on taxes, while only 9% said it was okay. 72% agreed that it's every American's civic duty to pay their fair share of taxes. The survey was conducted by the IRS Oversight Board, an independent agency that offers guidance to the IRS, Pat.
Well, I think it was Judge Learned Hand that says, we do not have a moral obligation, much less any other obligation, to order our affairs to the convenience of the Treasury Department. And so if there are tax loopholes, opportunities to have legitimate tax avoidance, well, that's the American way. And we say our fair share, well, what is the fair share? But the smart guys have got their taxes set up so that they don't pay very much. And those loopholes are in the law. So if you want to fix something, fix the law. But nevertheless, we don't have any moral obligation to pay the government any more than the law requires. Lee?
A Texas Republican has introduced a bill that would eliminate IRS late fees. They're calling it the Rangel Rule. Representative John Carter wrote the bill to draw attention to legal issues surrounding House Ways and Means Chairman Charlie Rangel. He's undergoing investigation for failing to pay IRS penalties on thousands of dollars in real estate taxes. Carter says the bill will focus on what he believes to be a double standard between citizens and government officials. The public approves of most of President Obama's decisions since taking office, but not all of them. According to a new Gallup USA Today poll, 76% approve of the president naming a special envoy to the Middle East, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. 76% also approve of his move to tighten rules on people working as lobbyists, either before or after serving in his administration. But only 44% approve of his decision to close the prison at Guantanamo Bay. And his least popular decision? 35% approve of restoring funding for overseas family planning groups that provide abortions or offer abortion counseling. Women in Afghanistan are committing suicide every day by setting themselves on fire. In a nation where women are often oppressed, suicide has become a common practice to escape family problems. As George Thomas reports from Afghanistan, these cases are growing at an alarming rate. We do want to warn you, though, that this story does contain some disturbing images.
Some 400 miles from Kabul, in the western Afghan city of Herat, the local hospital's burn unit is struggling to help the dying. The smell of charred human flesh is unbearable. The screams of pain unending. Most here don't live to see another day.
They burn themselves because they see no other option.
Setting oneself on fire is the preferred method of suicide for many Afghan women, especially in Herat.
Sure, life has gotten a little better since the days of the Taliban. But the conditions for women haven't changed. They still suffer, and in some cases, it's getting worse for them.
The majority of the victims are girls and women who are forced into marriages. 60% of Afghan girls are married before the legal age of 16, and between 70 and 80% must endure forced marriages, often the marriages to an older man who has another wife and children. So setting themselves on fire has become a form of protest.
Most of these women are beaten and abused, If they run away, they are eventually caught and sent back to their families, and no one seems to care what happens to them after that.
Aid workers and human rights groups say that social, cultural, as well as religious restrictions often prevent Afghan women from getting the help they so desperately need.
21-year-old Fazela is one of the lucky ones who survived her suicide attempt.
I wanted to die, but God decided it was not my time. So now I have to live with my scars.
5 years ago, Fazela was engaged to marry her first cousin at the family's bidding. She refused and doused herself with fuel and set herself afire.
I wake up every day and see myself in the mirror and wish things were different.
She and other survivors are trying to make a difference. They occasionally travel around the country holding seminars and workshops on women's rights, but it's not easy. Afghan women who defy traditional gender roles and speak out against abuse are routinely threatened or killed.
One of the biggest challenges is to change the way men view us in this country. This is still a very patriarchal society.
Afghanistan's constitution gives equal rights to men and women, but despite an increase in the number of girls in school, most Afghan women, especially in rural areas, still lack full rights to work and education. Hundreds of schools and students have been attacked by Islamic militants who oppose advancements for women's rights. More than 6 years after the fall of the Taliban regime, the radical extremist group is making a strong comeback. And as the Taliban strengthen their hold on parts of the country, the future for women in much of Afghanistan looks bleaker. George Thomas, CBN News, Kabul.
Had a horrible situation there.
It breaks your heart, Lee, what's happened. Ladies and gentlemen, like it or not, it was your tax money that liberated Afghanistan from the Taliban. And we put in a government of Hamid Karzai. And therefore, it's ours. And if that's abuse against women takes place, it is our responsibility to stop it. The poppy crop is as flourishing and big, perhaps, as it ever has in history. It becomes the largest supplier of heroin in the world under our jurisdiction. What is the government of the United States doing? We're spending that. We're paying for it. It's your money and my money, our tax dollars, that are doing this. This terrible abuse of women. It is astounding what is happening. And if anybody talks about the wonders of Islam, just look at what they do to women in Afghanistan. And the same thing in a lesser degree, possibly in the, Saudi Arabia and other Arab countries. Women. Don't get a very good deal. Lee?
Pat, the worst snowfall in 18 years has brought much of Great Britain to a standstill. Parts of the UK have received as much as 10 inches of snow. And for a second day, many schools remain closed. Thousands of London commuters are still stranded as just a portion of the transport system is working. And drivers are being warned to stay off the icy roadways.
This is snowfall of a kind that we haven't seen for a couple of decades, and we don't have the snow plows that you might need. I congratulate everybody who's getting into work today.
It's great, great to see some snow, and I've got to look forward to a 90-minute journey home in it, so wish me well.
Prime Minister Gordon Brown says officials are doing all that they can to resume regular service for travel. Both runways at Heathrow Airport are now open, although some flights may still be canceled. But, Pat, it seems strange to see some of those great landmarks in London covered with snow.
Well, you wonder where my good friend Al Gore is when we need him, and what's happened to global warming. I don't understand. Lee?
A British nurse has been suspended and could lose her job because she offered to pray for one of her patients. Carolyn Petrie, a home care nurse from Somerset, England, says she didn't pray because the patient refused the offer. She said her employer suspended her without pay, saying she failed to demonstrate, quote, personal and professional commitment to equality and diversity. Ms. Petrie is a Baptist and married mother of two, and she has sought legal advice, Pat, from the Christian Legal Center.
He's kind of like the shock of the day from the UK. What in the world are those people thinking? They sing the national anthem, God Save the Queen. Yeah. You know?
Just don't pray for her.
Well, that's a prayer. God save the queen. That's a prayer. They all sing it. And to fire somebody because she says to a patient who's probably suffering with all kinds of grief, would you like me to pray for you? And all the patient's got to do is say, no, thank you.
Which is exactly what happened.
Yeah, but to fire her for not being sensitive to diversity? Oh, please. Well, while the big three automakers fight to stay alive, many foreign car manufacturers are holding their own right here in the United States. So what's the difference between the American companies and the foreign ones? Charlene Israel brings us that story from Montgomery, Alabama.
Alabama, considered by some to be the heart of the South, but to car makers like Mercedes-Benz, Honda, and Hyundai, this is car country. And the state has rolled out the welcome mat.
The companies coming in, I mean, it's been good because, you know, the economy's here. We've needed a boost, and it's brought in jobs, not only just the car manufacturers themselves, but also the companies that have to supply us with stuff.
This Hyundai plant here in Montgomery is just one of several foreign automakers wooed here by the state. It's a move that's put thousands of people in Alabama to work. Neil Wade heads Alabama's Economic Development Office.
About 130,000 Alabamians employed in the automotive industry. Most of those are in suppliers or in people supporting automotive industry. So the ripple effect, when you bring a Mercedes in and they're going to hire 2,000 direct workers, you can use a multiplier of 5 or 6 to 1 with the number of other jobs that are going to be created.
While Chrysler and General Motors wait for billions in government bailout loans, these plants are moving forward. Why the big difference? Unions or lack of them.
The assembly plants are not union, but we're a right-to-work state. And what that means is that the workforce in a plant makes the decision whether they would be union or they would not be union. And that's something that we celebrate is it's the workforce that makes the decision, not that a company comes in and forces or says we're going to be union or not.
That means lower wage and benefit costs, which add up to big savings for these companies. For example, Hyundai's workers, including all benefits, make almost $28 an hour, less than half the typical GM union worker. That's because GM must cover pension costs for current workers and pay for the needs of its retirees to the tune of more than $37,000 per person per year. GM has 360,000 retirees. In America, Hyundai has zero.
I think the big three really can learn from the automakers in the Southeast. I think there are a lot of lessons in terms of how they have set up their operation, how they train, and also the products that are being produced at these assembly plants.
With the U.S. recession hurting sales across the board, production has slowed down somewhat in the foreign car plants. But for the most part, money in the bank and good credit ratings are helping them ride out the storm. On the other hand, Chrysler stopped all U.S. production for 1 month, leaving 46,000 union workers without a regular paycheck. In January, Ford shut down 10 plants for an extra week to save money, and GM is stopping construction of an engine plant in Michigan. The Big Three's leaders say these moves combined with government help and massive restructuring will make a difference. But former Montgomery Mayor Bobby Bright, who helped to bring Hyundai to the city, says any bailout is a big mistake.
The bailout is rewarding, in my opinion, poor management, decades of poor management.
Residents in Montgomery gave us their take on why foreign automakers aren't asking for a government bailout.
I would assume that it would be because they're not in the financial condition that those other companies are. I believe that to be a good thing.
However, many in the foreign auto industry here want to see the competition succeed.
We need them to keep producing too, because losing any of the big three would, you know, hurt the United States economy too much. We definitely don't need them to go out of business.
Charlene Israel, CBN News.
Well, hopefully that package was set up so that, you know, when the bailout comes, that they'll make reforms. It was supposed to be in there. And they've got to reform those union contracts. They were just too generous.
Yeah, absolutely. Wow. I mean, when you see those numbers side by side, that's pretty incredible.
Well, you know, GM actually set up a job bank when they laid people off, and they got their full salaries. They were in this. They didn't have to work. All they had to do was just collect their their pay. And it just was folly, total and utter folly. You know, it's what's called tough love you need.
Yes.
They didn't have it. All right.
Eric Holder has been confirmed as the nation's first African-American attorney general. After initiating some delays, many Republicans voted to confirm President Obama's nomination. There was concern for Holder's role in the controversial pardon of financier Mark Rich, and also Holder's involvement in helping some Puerto Ricans gain clemency. Holder is expected to review and reverse several of the Bush administration's policies, particularly on terrorism. Kentucky's governor has raised the death toll from the winter storm that struck the state last week to 24. The storm has been blamed for 55 deaths nationwide, and the cleanup around the Bluegrass State continues. The National Guard has also been mobilized to help distribute supplies. So far, Kentucky officials say the government has responded well to their requests for assistance. Operation Blessing is also in the state, helping distribute needed supplies, including heaters and blankets. You can find out more about Operation Blessing's efforts and our other CBN news stories by going to our website at cbn.com.